Hi, everyone, and welcome to our discussion on job costing. So to get started, we first want to distinguish between two types of costing. And the first one is job costing, which is what this discussion will focus on. And this is where you have either batch or unique specialized jobs that we're completing or services that we are providing. Some examples of this would be like yacht building. So typically you won't produce thousands of this exact same yacht because these are high ticket items. Someone will come in and order a specific type of yacht. What type of countertops do they want? What size do they want? How long do they want it? How wide do they want it? So it's not cookie cutter, for example. So one job that you're completing. A high-end home building. People come in and say, this is the house I want to build. So it's one-time deal. It's not that you're producing thousands of the exact same house. Dell Computer used to be, I don't know if they still are, but Dell Computer used to be where you would call in and you would tell Dell Computer exactly what computer you would want. They would build it for you. That would be an example of job costing. A computer company that produces thousands and thousands of the same computer with the same RAM, same hard drive, that is an example of process costing. Process costing is when you're producing the identical units through a series of productions or processes or steps. Okay, so like a number two pencil maker. They're making millions of number two pencils over and over and over again. They're all identical. They're the same. They go through the exact same process to be completed. A cereal maker, for example, Lucky Charms, one of my favorite cereals. They are produced over and over and over again. The process does not change. So someone doesn't call in and say, I want a special box of Lucky Charms. That's not the way it works. So this is the difference between job costing and process costing. So as we're going through this series of videos, we're going to be talking about completing one job, one special job for people. So before we get into our deeper discussion of job costing, let's do a little bit of review about how costs flow through a manufacturer's inventory account. So you remember these are our three inventory accounts for a manufacturing company. We have materials, work in process, and finished goods. So let's start by inputting the information that we know belongs in these three inventory accounts. So they are inventory accounts, so therefore they're assets. They carry normal debit balances. So we have our beginning and ending balances. We know that if we buy more materials, that will make it go up, so that's our purchases. We also know that if we pay freight to get the materials to us as the buyer, that also increases the value of our materials, and that goes into our materials account. When we use materials, they go into work in process, as far as our discussion is right now. So in our work in process, we have our three product costs, direct materials, direct labor, and overhead. And in work in process, we're working on a product or a job. We're getting that job completed. Once it is completed, it moves out of work in process as cost of goods manufactured into finished goods. And then that product stays in finished goods until it is sold. And then once it is sold, it is costed as cost of goods sold. Now we're going to add some more T accounts to this flow of cost idea. We're going to add wages payable. We're going to add an overhead T account, as well as our cost of goods sold T account. And we're going to just see how all these costs flow from one place to another. So I'm going to draw a little map, if you will. So recall that our used materials thus far went into process. Those direct materials went directly into process. Cost of goods manufactured moved into finished goods. So we know where our direct materials came from, but we really don't know where direct labor comes from. We really don't know where overhead comes from. So let's start by looking at the overhead T account. On the left-hand side of the overhead T account, we have what's called actual overhead. This is the overhead that's actually incurred. On the right-hand side of the overhead T account, we have what's applied. You also may hear that called allocated. And we'll talk about that a little bit later, not in this particular video, but in a later discussion. So here we have our actual overhead, which is made up of those three things we've talked about before. The three components of overhead are indirect materials, indirect labor, and other overhead. So remember also we've talked about how materials houses all of our materials. So if we're working on a wooden chair, for example, it would not just include wood, but it would include the screws and the glue, the nails, whatever we need. All of our materials would be housed in that materials T account. So when we have those used materials, there's actually two types of used materials. They would be direct and indirect materials. And the direct portion of those used materials goes directly into work in process. But the indirect materials of those used materials goes down into overhead. So you've got to make this distinction here. So the direct materials, which would be our wood, for example, for our wooden chair, would go directly into work in process. But the glue used, the screws, and the nails would likely go down into overhead as indirect materials. Now let's turn our discussion to labor. So we have that wages payable account down there, but remember from your financial accounting class, when you incurred wages, you expensed them immediately. You debited wages expense and you credited wages payable. But now we're in a manufacturing process where product costs do not get expensed until a product is sold. And that includes your labor, your direct labor, and your indirect labor. They're not going to get expensed until product is sold. So when we journalize this, we are going to credit wages payable, but we're going to debit some other accounts for our labor as opposed to our wages expense. So for our direct labor, we can see we are debiting work in process, and our indirect labor is getting debited to overhead. So notice we are not debiting wages expense. We're still crediting wages payable, but we're debiting work in process for the direct labor portion, and we're debiting overhead for the indirect labor portion. And then we've got other overhead, that third component of our actual overhead. That is going to be a credit to multiple payable accounts that you might owe, like utilities payable or something like that. So I don't really have those T accounts on here, but just note that could be multiple different payable accounts, liability accounts. Now later on, we're going to figure out where that applied overhead number comes from. But when we apply overhead, that is what gets put into process. Okay, so we're going to calculate that applied or allocated overhead amount, where I have the X's there. That's the number we will calculate. And that will be the number that gets applied directly into work in process. So very important that you notice that. It's not the actual overhead that gets applied to work in process. It's the right-hand side of the T account, the overhead account. So we're crediting overhead, debiting work in process. Remember, for every debit, there has to be a credit. So that's why it's moving that direction. So make sure you can make that distinction. And then again, we're working on a product. They're in work in process. So now we've got our direct materials. We've got our direct labor. We've got our applied overhead. We're putting this product together. It's completed. It becomes cost of goods manufactured and moves into finished goods. So we've got our debit and our credit there for cost of goods manufactured. And then it sits there until it is sold. Then, of course, we sell it. So whenever we make a sale, we know we have two journal entries. We record the revenue, which is not included here in these T accounts. And we have to record the cost, which is included here. And that's called cost of goods sold. So we're going to debit cost of goods sold and credit finished goods for that amount. So one last piece we want to talk about in this map that we're drawing is, let's go back to the overhead T account one more time. It's highly unlikely that your actual overhead will exactly equal your applied overhead. So we're going to end up with a balance in our overhead T account in most cases. And you'll see why that is as we get further into our discussion of calculating this applied overhead amount. But for now, let's say, for example, the actual overhead was more than our applied overhead. So our debits would be higher than our credits in our overhead T account. That would give us a debit balance in our overhead account. This means we have under-applied our overhead, which means we have not expensed enough. We haven't applied enough expense to this job. So we call that under-applied. So we have to increase our cost of goods sold. So if we end up with a debit balance in our overhead account, we have to get rid of it. We want that to be a zero balance in overhead. So if we have a debit balance, to get rid of that, we would have to credit overhead for that exact same amount. If we credit something, we have to debit something, and that is cost of goods sold. So notice cost of goods sold is getting debited for your under-applied overhead amount. Now the flip of that is, well, what if we apply too much cost? So in other words, our credit side of the overhead T account is more than the debit side, the actual side. So now we've applied too much cost, so our cost of goods sold is too high. We need to reduce our cost of goods sold. Keep in mind, cost of goods sold is an expense account, therefore it carries a debit balance. And to get rid or to reduce an expense account, we have to credit the account. So if we end up with over applied, meaning we've again applied too much cost, we would credit cost of goods sold with that over applied amount. Don't forget, if you enjoyed the video, give it a thumbs up, and questions and comments are always welcome.